Welcome into episode 41 of the Sources Say podcast, your go-to Kentucky basketball and recruiting podcast on the growing KSR podcast network. I'm your host, Jack Pilgrim of Kentucky Sports Radio, and today I'm happy to be joined once again by my friends Travis Graff and David Sisk of Cats Illustrated. Travis, what's going on, man? How are you?
Oh, just a big day in BBN, baby.
That's a very good way to put it. David, how are you? What's going on, man?
Man, did I miss something? I didn't know what we were going to talk about tonight.
Yeah. If you don't know what's going on, you're definitely living under a rock. Today was a very, very, very big day with the Kentucky basketball program as Wake Forest star center Olivier Sarr officially announces his commitment to the University of Kentucky. Obviously, huge news. We've talked about him a little bit. Honestly, this was we kind of talked about him in passing as a kind of a hypothetical situation, saying, okay, maybe if he does put his name in the transfer portal, we could. He puts his name in the transfer portal on Friday, doesn't officially get his – he announces his transfer Friday, doesn't officially get in until Tuesday, and then Wednesday afternoon he commits to Kentucky. So, obviously, this moved really, really fast, and we are here to break down everything, the ins and outs of it, how it came to fruition, what he's like as a player, everything you need to know about Olivier Sarr. We have it covered for you. So, before we get into the timeline of it all and how it all came together, I want the three of us to kind of sit down and talk about Olivier as a player first and what he's going to bring to the table on the court. So looking at the numbers, average 13.7 points, 9.0 rebounds, 1.2 blocks per game, shot 53% from the floor, all ACC third team, runner-up for most improved player in the ACC, 11 double-doubles, had a 20-point, 13-rebound game against Pitt, 30-point, 17 rebounds against Notre Dame, 25 points in a win over a top 10 ranked Duke team, 21-13 against a ranked Arizona team. You got on the list. His numbers are ridiculous, especially going into ACC play. He just turned it up to, you know, turned it up to a brand new level to close out the season. So, David, I want you to start this thing off by breaking down just who in the heck did Kentucky just sign to join the program next season?
One thing I think you got to remember is the numbers, as impressive as they are, you've got to take them in context, because he played on a team that was very undisciplined offensively, who was guard-centered, guys who didn't like to pass the ball, and he didn't get a whole lot of touches. I've got a story coming up with Terrence Oglesby, former player at Clemson, played professionally for 7 or 8 years, who is involved in ACC media now, watched him play several times. And, you know, that's one thing he talked about. He said it was, if you look at his numbers getting better as the year went, it's because he started getting touches in the last few games. And he said, you know, he felt like on a structured team, I got the ball to him, he could have done that all year. You know, looking at games, like you say, scoring 20, 25, 30 points each game. You're looking at offensively a guy who's ultra skilled. You always think that when you think European post players, just a lot of skill, can step out, shoot the three, really good in the face-up game, probably best around 15 feet or so in the mid post. I think he fits in well with what Kentucky has on the perimeter, their type of guards. He's not going to be a guy with a back to the bucket. And I've said all along, they don't want that. I think they need a guy who can step out, create space, you know, can attack from about 15 feet. But it gives room for B.J. Boston and also for Terrence Clark and guys like that to get to the rim. Defensively, he's not an ultra-great shot blocker, but he has some fluidity to him. He can move. He's 7 feet. He's long. And Terrence told me, you guys will get to see him in person before I will, that you're really going to be taken aback with how big he is. A big trunk to him, big in the butt, wide shoulders, 7 feet, 255, just a really, really a big player, has a lot of size and length to him. So he can rebound and he can block shots. Weakness, you know, not back to the bucket player, but I don't know that that is a weakness. But defensively, he's not going to be Nick Richards and E.J. Montgomery where he can step out on the floor and switch. They're going to have to hedge more with him. They're going to have to play more, rotate and help. Probably not going to guard point guards and two guards the way Nick Richards did. But, man, it's a great pickup, and he's a guy who you know, national championship and Final Four talk can begin because I got him on the team.
Travis, I know you tweeted earlier that there's already some speculation of 40-0 talk going on. Is that happening?
Yes. The 40-0 talk has already began on Twitter and on message boards. It's that time of the year, fellas. It's an electric time to be a Kentucky fan. Last week we were talking about – there was Kentucky fans talking about, like, are we going to be wasting Terrence Clark and B.J. Boston's year due to lack of a big man after missing on Harms, and rightfully so, but – looking back at it, after all the dust is cleared, I think guys, including myself, tried to make Harms be a fit just because he provided height and length and shot blocking and some stuff that Kentucky needed, but he wasn't a sure thing and never had proven to be a high-profile guy. And I think that we tried to build him up into something that Olivier Sarr is. Olivier Sarr is what people are hoping to get out of Matt Harms. Like you're talking about all the game logs, the 30 and 17 games, the 21 and 13 games. At 7 foot, he is still shooting 76% from the free throw line, something that Cal Perry's big on last year. Showed you how many close games you can win by just being a consistent free throw shooting team. Per 40 minutes, he averages 13.5 rebounds per game and 21 points per game last season. Still only 1.7 blocks per 40 minutes. Normally, out of 7 footers, you would see better numbers than that, but his rebounding rate is so high that it'll make up for Kentucky's overall length next year. Is probably going to be, and athleticism is going to be nice. So you're not going to need him to swat a ton of shots. He can, but he's not really an above the rim athlete. He's talented, like David said, up to 15 feet. Doesn't really step out and shoot threes at all, but he can definitely alter shots at the rim, and I think he's just what the doctor ordered because he's a guy that – back to Harms. Harms is a guy that I don't know how many sets you could have ran for him because everybody knows Cal Perry loves running his offense through a post touch. Mm-hmm. And Sarr is a guy that can go to work down there and operate and get his own shot. I don't know if Harms could have done that consistently. I don't know if anybody else on the roster for Kentucky could have done that consistently next year. And – when you look at the other options that Kentucky has, I think that Sarr was the biggest need, and I'll get to this here in a minute, but I heard that obviously he was the number one option for Kentucky as of a couple days ago. But you look like DeAndre Williams. DeAndre Williams is skinny, 6'10", kind of people around him trying to push that he's a 3 and he's a 4, kind of like Keon Brooks.
Yeah.
Probably not as high of a ceiling. So you look at Sarr. Sarr was something that nobody on Kentucky's roster this season compared to. And I think that he fits like a glove, and it'll allow Kentucky to bring in somebody like Frank Anselm and work them along and bring him up to speed behind a guy like Sarr. But go ahead. We'll talk about the recruitment here in a minute.
Yeah. I think you guys both bring up good points talking about Nick Richards, just about how this – not necessarily that they're the same player, but in terms of just being an anchor down low where you know, there's that proven, consistent product. I think that's what fans are going to be most excited for when it comes to this newest addition. I think that, you know, they have their slight differences, but just in terms of knowing that you're going to get a 14-9 type guy every time he steps on the floor, there's just so much value in that. Think about all the times at the offense last year. It just seemed like nothing was working. They couldn't get the ball in the basket. You know, they were really struggling on the floor. Nick Richards oftentimes ended up being kind of that savior for him, that kind of, you know, get a few shots going, you know, make a clutch block here and there, just kind of that stable force to allow everything else to go into motion and then ultimately, you know, put Kentucky ahead to win games. He was that stable
Terrence
force.
Terrence told me, if I can interrupt for a second, Terrence told me, we talked about this a lot in stories coming up, that he said, listen, he's not a Nick Richards. You know, defensively, he's different. Probably not quite the defender Nick was, but offensively, Nick's not in the ballpark with him because he said he can step out and shoot the three, and he shot the three over people in Atlantic Coast Conference. His comparisons were, he said, kind of to a Robert Horry, mm-hmm. as far as being able to step out and the big game Bob. You know, that would be a great one. But one that he really kind of compared him to was with Zach Collins, that played at Gonzaga, yeah. now with Portland Trailblazers.
I just don't see that from three-pointer, though, because he only attempted like 0.2, like first career he's averaging 0.6 per game and shooting like 23%. I think he definitely has the stroke, though. You look at his mid-range stroke is nice. I think he could definitely step out and improve on that number. I think that'll be something that Kentucky probably sold him on. Come here, we'll work on your stretch big game as well.
Well, it may come down to what Wake Forest just didn't do anything on offense. And, you know, Kelly Quinlan talked about that last week. When I talked to him in a story, he's the Rivals publisher. But Terrence kind of doubled down on that this week, that, you know, it was guards dribbling around. They really didn't do much. They just dribbled around, and somebody threw up a 35-footer. So, you know, I didn't watch them enough to really say, I know this is a fact, but it just sounds like from what I'm hearing, you know, he never was able to get involved in a pick-and-pop game, or if he did stretch them out, he never did get the ball.
Yeah, I mean, just in terms of instant impact guys, I mean, you can't emphasize enough how massive it is to get, you know, to see what is leaving the program this offseason, and to see what's coming in with Isaiah Jackson, Lance Ware, Keon Brooks being a, you know, a small ball four, to have that little depth down low and so few options in the grand scheme of things before this option kind of came to fruition. I mean, the night and day difference between just last week when we did this show going, shoot, is McCurr Maker the answer? Are we going to have to, you know, give a bunch of minutes to Frank Anselm next year? I mean, you know, there was a lot of doubt just this time last week, and just to kind of completely replace that high impact, you know, major contributor, veteran leader, that type of guy. I mean, it's just, you know, night and day. I mean, that is just huge, huge, huge for the program. Okay, as for the commitment itself, it's fairly obvious that from the second Sarr entered the transfer portal that Kentucky was going to make him their top priority. I mean, shoot, I'd argue that the fans let him know that they were, you know, he was their top priority before he even made it into the transfer portal, you know, flooding his social media and commenting on all of his posts and all that. So there was speculation that there was immediate mutual interest. David, I know we talked about it behind the scenes beforehand, but you were the first person to publicly break that news that contact had been made. Now that the dust has settled a little bit, when did that initial contact take place between Kentucky and Sarr's camp?
I don't know the exact time that it happened, but what I do know is I got a call from a publisher on the Rivals Network, and yeah, I didn't call him. He contacted me, and he said, and these were his words, I said, you can take this for whatever it's worth, but I thought you might want to know. He said, I just spoke to a coach in the ACC, and he told me, and I'm going to say something here that I'm not going to say on our message boards because I modified it. I didn't want to give the full money here because, you know, you put stuff out and you can't reel it back. But he said, I talked to an ACC coach, and he said that Olivier is going to Kentucky. Really, head coach or assistant coach? And he said this was a head coach. And he said there may be an option that he goes back to Wake Forest. He's also, you know, could look professionally, maybe overseas, but, you know, from what I've told, it's going to be one of those three, but his words were he thinks he's going to go to Kentucky. I didn't even put that up on our boards. I just put down Kentucky was in a good spot because you guys know you put that up, man, and then you're sitting around worrying for the rest of the
And you told me and Justin that a couple of days ago.
Yeah.
Before you even posted anything on that. So
yeah. And that it can get out of hand in a hurry, so I was very cautious about it. But we definitely knew the contact had been made, and I thought that was verified a little bit. You know, there's going to be the infamous talk that Steve Forbes had with Sarr, but even in that, you know, when he said, "Why would you want to go somewhere like Kentucky?" and there really weren't even a whole lot of reports out about Kentucky being in contact with him, that tells you there that Coach Forbes knew that Sarr and Kentucky, and I think Travis has got a lot to add to this, you know, that Sarr and Kentucky were pretty serious.
Yeah, Travis, you know, on that note, what, you know, how fast do you think this thing came together behind the scenes, and just how early do you think Kentucky knew that they had him?
I think that this has been working behind the scenes for quite a while now, at least ever since it was rumored that he was going to be entering the transfer portal. And I tell you what, Kentucky was keeping this thing silent. It was radio silence on Kentucky's end for the most part. The only thing that I'd heard leading up to it was something I'd heard two nights ago that I posted this morning. Luckily, I got it on before he posted, before he committed. I put that I was hearing that the Kentucky's main plan right now was, which was a couple days ago, was to get Sarr on board and then go after Anselm. Mm-hmm. That those two were what they felt would be the best fit to round out this roster. I know DeAndre Williams was an option, still is an option, but I don't know if what he wants and needs is going to be able to be given in a place like Kentucky. He wants the ball. He's not going to be the featured player next year. He wants to be more of a wing player at 6'10". Cal Perry's going to put him on the block for the most part, let him put him in the corner as well. But I think what he wants to showcase he won't be able to next year on next year's team. And hell, he might not even start over Keon Brooks. So that makes complete sense whenever they said that about Frank Anselm. I posted that early this morning, and I think that, like I said, we had all heard stuff about Harms, and I think that after the Harms stuff went wrong, I think that they're like, all right, let's play this one close to the vest.
Yeah.
And because that was the only thing I'd heard. I'd never heard a day. I'd never heard – I knew UK was in a pursuit. I'd heard that, but I'd never heard the seriousness. It was just, like I said, radio silence on their end. So,
yeah, I think you bring up a good point, because the one of my main contacts that usually is, you know, pretty, you know, cautious, but still open to some level of communication, kind of shut down as soon as the Sarr stuff started talking. Wasn't able to confirm if, when, what level of contact had been made. I mean, you could just tell that there were instructions from up top to make sure that this does not leak out, that how fast things were moving. They did not want the public to know, that they wanted this to move fast and to get this thing wrapped up and move on to the next step. I mean, this was – I mean, I think –
Well, he had already talked about how – nuts, essentially. I'll say it for him, how nuts the UK fans are. And if anything else had leaked on that to give Kentucky fans any more of an inkling that he's going to come, oh my God. He already had to turn off the comments on his Instagram and close
the DM. That's one thing, too. And my wife is just, and she loves it, but she can't believe that Kentucky fans are into it as much as they are. And but she loves it, though, because she's just kind of the same way.
I have a feeling, like, whenever I was thinking about this earlier, a good metaphor for Kentucky is, like, when John Calipari is trying to show off the program, it's like he's walking out to the end of his sidewalk to bring in this house guest to this huge mansion. And he's got, like, three barking dogs that are, like, huge pit bulls out in the front yard. And Calipari's like, don't mind them. And that's UK fan.
But I told her, because I remember Friday week ago, that's when I had kind of tweeted, what's when Sarr was announced that he was going to transfer. And I put something on Twitter that this is going to be a name that Kentucky fans are, you know, better look at, better expect that there's going to be noise over this one. And I'm not going to say it was the first one, but it was one of the first ones. And then I look up and there's so many likes and retweets and all that stuff. And then they're starting to talk about people blowing his DMs up. And my first thought was, why in the world does he have a DM on his Twitter open? You know, but I told my wife, I said, man, if he gets cold feet on this, where he's not, he's scared of Kentucky because of all the contact and stuff. And I feel like we put the tweet up had anything to do with that. I'll go and hide somewhere.
Yeah, it was there was a little sense of nervousness, like, man, I'm worried that that's going to be what turns him off, and you know, I think there was some kind of speculation on Twitter, like fans going, guys, shut up, he's onto us, don't let him, you know, see the true side of us yet. Like, it was that you could tell there was some speculation on their side that they certainly didn't want to push him away, knowing how important he is. You know, on that note, you know, kind of the back and forth between, you know, Wake Forest and trying to that dynamic of trying to keep him, Kentucky in pursuit of him. Wake Forest coach Steve Forbes definitely made headlines when he went on a radio show and threw a pretty solid jab at Kentucky. We talked about it. We hinted at it just a little bit ago, but, you know, said the exact quote was, why would you go to Wake for 3 years, put all that time in for a prestigious degree, and end up getting your degree from a place like Kentucky? And things just kind of unraveled and went out of hand very, very quickly after that. You know, we don't need to talk about if we thought it was disrespectful or anything like that. I think we all know that A, it was a slight jab, and B, that people have already talked about it, you know, the insides and outs of it, on social media, various radio shows in the last day. But I am interested in the timing of the comments now that we do know that he committed less than 24 hours after that fact. Travis, do you think that he knew at that time that Olivier was either leaning toward Kentucky, or that, you know, or is it just an honest point? Like, what do you think, you know, now knowing what you know, what really went into that radio appearance?
Now, a lot of y'all aren't going to want to hear what I'm about to say here, but Mark Ennis was 100% right on Twitter today. He said that he already knew that Sarr was going to go to Kentucky, and that this was a ply for pretty much the fans to get behind him and kind of play that card whenever, like, oh, I don't know why that kid would do that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And I think he played that card perfectly. But I tell you what, that is such a goober statement by their coach. I think that once you start playing academics, when you're talking high level basketball, you're already dead in the water. When academics is the first thing that you're going to. And I tell you what, I've lost brain cells watching that coach announcement video that they made. Did you see that?
Oh, it was so cringeworthy.
Oh my god. I felt like I was watching two middle schoolers flirting or something like, it's something super cringeworthy.
I mean, the low budget mask, the you know, them throwing it down.
I talked to the board of trustees. That's how he started the video or something. Ugh. He said something like that.
God,
like, oh my god, like, imagine being Wake Forest.
Yeah, it was very, very, very cringy. David,
you know that was the AD Tennessee fired over because he was going to hire Greg Schiano, right?
Yeah, I do now.
Yeah. John Kerr, yeah. That was the one Clay Travis started firestorm over.
Gosh. David, I know you kind of touched on it a little bit earlier, but talk to me about that timing. Do you think that there was anything to it? Do you think that he had already known that recruitment was over and he was doing a last-ditch effort?
I just think he was giving it a pit. I've known Steve Forbes for a while, and I'm going to say this. I like him. I really do. Now, not because of it. I've known him well before this. But I've said all along, you know, I grew up in East Tennessee. I spent a lot of time at East Tennessee State, Johnson City. And I'll pull for that team on that level and that program. And I've talked to him a lot of times before the AAU tournaments and before that at other places. And one thing I've liked about him, he's not politically correct. And If you want an honest answer, he'll give you one. I've heard him talk about Bruce Pearl before. I think my jaw just hit the floor when he talked about it. He's going to tell you what's on his mind. So, I think that a lot of that stuff is refreshing in a way, but I just feel like on this deal, he was going to try to, like you said, he knew he was in a crunch here and he was just going to come out and try to use every bit of ammunition that he could. You know, it is going to be scorched earth. And I do think the academic part of it, of Wake Forest, is going to be interesting because I've even got friends that really like him who are worried for him because of taking the Wake Forest job because they don't know that he's how good of a fit this is going to be because, you know, Wake Forest is bow ties, private school, really kind of an old South private school type. I had a guy tell me today it's really hard to tell the difference between Wake Forest and Furman, and Forbes has been public school coach JUCO,
yeah.
And he's built his programs around transfers and junior college players, and academics has never been a big issue, and now he's going to a place where, you know, he's trying to play that card, and it's totally out of character for what he's been used to. So I think it was an awkward attempt by a coach who's come in, the cupboard's bare, and he's at a totally different place than he's ever been.
Yeah, and I will say that that on Kentucky side of things, they didn't take it as this huge stab in the back that I think the general public made it out to be. I think fans kind of made a bigger deal about it than I think the Kentucky coaching staff. I don't think it's necessarily because they agreed with Kentucky being an inferior academic institution, because I don't think they genuinely do. But I think it was more so that was the biggest hurdle for them to clear to get Sarr. You know, they knew they won on all accounts when it comes to, you know, just being better at basketball, better facilities, better coach, better track record with bigs, and just the flat out opportunity to win. They knew they had all those checks marked, but could they top that familiarity and the comfort with the program and you know, him being there for 3 years, especially being so close to a degree from an institution like Wake? And I think Wake's side kind of overreacted to you know, Wake being like, you know, this Harvard or Yale. I mean, that's not – they're a high-level academic institution, but let's not treat them like an Ivy League school. I think there's a kind of a delusion on that side of things from their perspective. But I think in the wise words of DeMarcus Cousins, this ain't no spelling bee. I think Sarr's going to Kentucky entirely for basketball purposes, and that's it. I think it's, you know, he wants to play in the NBA, plain and simple, and that's what it boiled down to. He, you know, when he made his public announcement, he mentioned that in his little, you know, paragraph or whatever, saying, you know, I appreciate what this school has provided me for 3 years. You know, this was, you know, some of the best time of my life, but it was time for me to make this next step forward. And that step forward is I need to be at a place that can push me to my, you know, professional future. I appreciate.
Well, he went to Wake Forest for one reason. And I don't think I've said this on here. I don't think we've covered Sarr. I wasn't on last week. I don't think we talked about Sarr since the last time I was on here.
Nope.
But when he came out of France, he had narrowed it, if I'm not mistaken, to Wake Forest, Cal, and Vanderbilt. I think there may have been another one in, but I know that was the big three. And obviously, I did some work with the Vanderbilt side on basketball recruiting. And he went to Wake Forest for one reason, and that was Danny Manning. And he believed Danny Manning could make him the best he could be. And, you know, even talking with Kelly Quinlan last week, Kelly told me, he said, look, I don't think he was a very good head coach. I was wondering what in the world he was doing most of the time. Said the offensive setup was horrible. He couldn't control the team. But there was one thing he could do. He was a very good post developer, and he could make big men better. And when he left, I mean, I don't know how much familiarity there was with Wake Forest, because the reason he came there was gone. And either way it went, he was going to be playing for a new head coach as a senior.
Yeah. Yeah.
Something I'm looking forward to. I think it's going to be cool as hell to watch the transformation. By the second month of the season, that man is going to have a knockdown right hand over left shoulder hook shot, the patented Kenny Payne post move that he teaches all of his bigs. And that is what's going to get him a mid second round or higher selection next year when he wasn't on draft boards this season.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think, I mean, the proof is in the pudding. Whether the recruiting, you know, product has shown lately with, you know, in the front court, the proof is in the pudding that you go to Kentucky and you are going to develop in the front court under Kenny Payne like nowhere else in the country. I mean, that is, I mean, you go to Kentucky to develop as a big man. And that's, you know, he wants to have that one last ditch effort at college to develop for that NBA and to be better prepared, you know, to be an instant impact guy in the NBA versus, you know, playing the G League and all that. He wants that immediate success by, you know, changing his scenery. And he did it in the best way possible. You know, he knew that's where he wanted to go. There was, you know, it was a pretty cut and dry decision. He had the opportunity to go back to Wake. You know, the professional option was still there. The likes of Duke and, you know, Florida, some other big name schools all reached out to him. But I think, you know, considering he was only officially in the transfer portal starting yesterday to the official decision coming Wednesday afternoon, it's very apparent that this was a long time coming, at least internally on his side of things, knowing that he wanted to end up at Kentucky. Okay, now that we...
Can I say one other thing?
Yeah, go
one
for
other quick thing. Terrence Oglesby thinks that the guy I was talking to that played at Clemson, that I was talking about earlier, he thinks he's talented enough to go in a draft next year in the 20s. In the first round. He says the only reason he wouldn't be a lottery is because of his age. He said if he had the talent now and size and everything as 18-year-old that he has now, he'd be a lottery. So he said that was a thing working against him. And one other interesting thing, too, talking about Danny Manning, he would have probably gone out and gone pro. And what I heard, Danny Manning talked him into coming back for a senior year at Wake Forest. That's how close they were. And then he comes back and it goes past the entry deadline into the NBA draft, and then Manning gets fired. If they would have fired Danny Manning right after the season, which I think a lot of us thought might happen, Kentucky might not ever had that shot. He might have went on to the pros.
Yeah, and I think that's a very good lead into the big million-dollar question. Will he even be eligible to play college basketball next year? You know, we can talk about how good he is and how great of a fit it is until we're blue in the face, but if he can't play because the NCAA denies his waiver request, it's all a moot point. So, David, we've talked about this in depth on the phone in recent days. Where do you think things stand with the waiver process and the odds that Olivier does win his case? Do you think that the NCAA will now be lenient with, you know, everything going on?
I want to tonight to really go through and when I have some time and go back and look at some transfers who left because their coach were fired and see exactly how that turned out. I have spoken with individual college coaches who even beforehand when we talked about Sarr like last week, some thought he would get instant eligibility, some didn't. There were more that thought he would. I think that's in the majority. But in the minority part of it, you know, there's a difference, a national letter of intent when a player comes out of high school and an individual that I spoke with who thought it might not happen was he said it's just easier to do it for kids who are coming out of high school than it is for ones who are staying, or ones who've already been there, rather. But I would have to go back and look. Like I said, most of them think that he's going to be granted eligibility. And I think they can get that one done behind the scenes. With everything going on now, the one-time deal didn't pass, but they've got so much on their plate with COVID-19, the NCAA does. I don't know that how much they want to fight all of these, that if coaches are fired, that guys can go on and go to other places. And, you know, Wake Forest is going to have about 10 of them out there floating around. So, you know, we're going to see. Personally, I lean toward him playing at Kentucky next year. I'd be ineligible. I just couldn't imagine with a coach being fired going into senior season it not happening.
Travis, we've talked behind the scenes. There's one thing in particular I want you to say on this show that we've talked about. What do you think the chances are that we see Sarr on the floor this season?
Well, it's kind of trying to throw a dart to see what the NCAA is going to do consistently, so I'm not going to speak on their behalf. But I talked to somebody close to the Kentucky program that said that, quote, we would not bring him in if he was going to sit. And that might be overly optimistic on that part, on their part, but that's what they told me. And then John Hill had
I believe that, Travis. I don't have any input on that, but I've thought that. Calipari's just too smart.
But then again, you know how Calipari works. He's all about the kids. I could see him being like, all right, well, if you're not going to get a waiver, well, actually, that wouldn't make sense because he could have went back to Wake Forest and showcased everything. What I was going to say was, just spitballing here, that we'd come here and develop you better than you would develop at Wake Forest. If you can't play, you can go professionally overseas and, like you talked about, get paid after a couple months of Kentucky development. But that was just spitballing. But John Hill said something earlier that I thought was a really good point. He said, Sarr's specific case, based on what he told ESPN, is that Danny Manning convinced him not to enter the draft when Wake fired Manning after Sarr couldn't change his mind. So,
yeah.
I think that if they played that card, I think that that's their meal ticket right there.
So
that, and I know that's true for a fact because I was told that last week by Kelly Quinlan. And I didn't even know that John had said that. I've not even read the ESPN, what he said on ESPN. I've not even read it. But I know for a fact, like I said, that's what Kelly told me last week, and that's what I was referring to a while ago, that, you know, he talked him into coming back, and then, you know, he got fired after it was too late to declare for the NBA.
Yeah, that's what Sarr said in that interview. He said, I had like 24 hours. He said, you know, literally, you know, you kind of mentioned this earlier. This wasn't, you know, Danny Manning getting fired as soon as their last game, you know, back in March. I mean, it's been well over a month since they'd played their last game. They waited all the way up until this deadline. Danny Manning convinced him to return.
They had so many transfers, and when Chandy Brown, you can go back and look at the timelines, when Chandy Brown, Trenton, who's really good, transferred out of there, that was just about every player that he had brought in over a 2 or 3 year span. I think like 8 or 9 out of 10 players. And they said that was a straw that broke the camel's back. And that was like 2 weeks ago. And that's when they rounded up the money to get him gone. That if Brown hadn't transferred out, he'd probably still be there, but they were just losing every player they had.
Yeah, I think it's been really frustrating watching the national media, how they've kind of all circled together in this big, like, you know, coming together saying, oh, the NCAA has never granted immediate eligibility to kids due to their coaches being fired. Why would this be a case different? It's like, because this is not a cut and dry, my coach was fired argument. I mean, he literally said, he told Danny Manning, I am going to go to the NBA. Danny Manning argued for him and said, hey, I really think you should come back for one final year at Wake Forest. He goes, all right, I'm going to trust my longtime head coach in this decision. He gets fired. I mean, he literally said, it was like, I had 24 hours to make a decision. I didn't have enough time to even look through my options and say, okay, do I want to, you know, put my name in the draft and all that? I mean, this is a timing NBA issue more than it is my coach was fired. It was the fact that he didn't give that opportunity to, I mean, his hand was forced. I think Sarr's argument is that his fate was decided for him. I think it's a very, very valid argument. With their national media saying that it's, you know, there isn't a precedent with this, how the looking back in the history of kids that have you know, decided to transfer and put in waivers for that, how they haven't been granted in the past. It's like, okay, yes, in a normal year, most of the time, that's not how this would go. But they've also, you know, we're in unprecedented times right now. Unprecedented decisions are being made and have to be made right now. It's like, yeah, they've also never canceled a freaking NCAA tournament before due to a global pandemic. Like, this is just different times. in a usual instance, maybe, you know, maybe he wouldn't get this. But because of everything else going on, and, you know, I feel like now more than ever, there's internal pressure to do right by these kids. And I mean, I know that's saying a lot, because considering the NCAA has been so wishy-washy about everything. But now more than ever, it does feel like they have pressure on them to make these kids happy and do what's best for them, you know, considering how things ended last season. So with everything being said, on top of the fact that his argument is just valid more than anything, and, you know, the fact that this rule's already in the works. They're trying. It's not about if this thing is going to pass the instant, immediate, you know, waiver transfer waiver. That's going to pass at some point. It's just about when. And the fact that that's already in the works, you know, are they really going to nitpick about specific waivers right now? And, you know, what, you know, how bad is it that this kid didn't get an opportunity to go back? You know, I don't think when it boils down to it, I don't think that they're going to care as much as they used to in the past, because they have much more on their hands, like, oh, I don't know, trying to determine if college basketball is even going to be played in the first place. So, yeah, I think when it boils down to it, the NCAA is going to say, screw it. Anybody that has been going through this stuff has a somewhat legitimate argument on their side. They're gonna pass it. I know Kyle Tucker came out in the last couple hours and said the people on Wake's side of things don't believe Sarr is gonna receive immediate eligibility, and that's another thing. How much are they gonna be willing to help considering all this side stuff going on? I don't know. There's so much stuff going on outside of things.
Well,
but
he can't. Like I said, Steve Forbes can't. He doesn't need that firestorm right now.
Yeah.
Now, you talk about the media doing an about face, because, like you say, right now they're lining up against Kentucky a little bit. But if Wake Forest doesn't release him, and you see it, you can go back and look at other instances where coaches didn't release players, and the national media came down on them.
I mean, yeah.
You talk about a firestorm, he would get it, and the media would do an about face. But another thing is, you know, you talk about doing what's best for the kid. I'm not convinced that Danny Manning really did that. This is just speculation. I'm not saying, but hear me out here, because very rarely will you hear a coach tell a player, hey, man, come back.
Yeah.
They're like, you know, if you're ready to go, we'll support you. But he has him to come back, and he already has this on his shoulders about players leaving. And he's got through the season by the skin of his teeth. And I just wonder if he felt like, too, that if Olivier Sarr gets away, like, you know, that fire might really come clearer than what he was hoping. So I'm wondering if he's pulling a whole Olivier Sarr, please come back, be able to save his skin.
Yeah, I think another thing to factor in is all of the, you know, Calipari being so gracious in terms of you know, other past players that have transferred out, the Jamal Bakers of the world vouching for him. Why the hell did Jamal Baker get eligibility at Arizona, you know, immediately right away? That could be a major argument for Calipari. He'd be like, dude, I have gone, you know, I've let anybody transfer out whenever they wanted to, try to help them get immediate eligibility wherever they've gone. I've vouched for them. For the love of God, give me this opportunity with this. I've done my part. Please, can you guys throw me one bone? Shoot, Johnny Juzang's leaving in the portal right now, trying to go back home for immediate eligibility. Calipari's already said he's going to vouch for him and say, please, he deserves to go home. He wants to be, you know, back home with his family. He if there's anything that is working out in Calipari's end, is that he's done more than enough behind the scenes to try to, you know, do his part for this time when this day doesn't inevitably, you know, did inevitably come, for him to need, you know, the NCAA to scratch his back a little bit. Okay.
You know, something that we haven't talked about, this isn't waiver talk, but something that will get Kentucky fans really excited, is that he is arguably the number one grad transfer in the country. That's equivalent to a top 10 to 15 recruit. And you will know a school that had reached out to Jack, and I had heard this earlier, and then Eric Bossy came on Cat's Illustrated with a lot of insider information on the whole Sarr situation. And he told me that Jack and I both heard that Duke had reached out to Sarr. So he picked Kentucky. Bossy said that he knew that he's going to Kentucky from the jump. And so he didn't even listen to what Duke had to say. So that's going to make Kentucky fans feel even more grateful and get off of some of the coaches' backs whenever it comes to recruiting misses. And realize what just happened here.
Yeah.
All of this comes down to, it's pretty much beating out a team like Duke for a player that they wanted that's the equivalent of a top 10 high school player.
Speaking of top 10 high school players, the 24/7 updated rankings came out today, and Duke does not have any of those said players, while Kentucky has two, the only school in the nation that can say they had such a feat. So if you want more reasons to, you know, Kentucky coaching staff to pat themselves on the back after a very impressive day today, that is another thing to look at.
Another thing I was going to add real quick about Sarr is he has a younger brother that is going to be a freshman. He's over in France, and he's already, like, they said that he's, like, much better than his brother was at this stage. He's, like, 6'10".
Already
he's 6'10". He's going to play for Real Madrid over there for a couple of years. And then, like, and they're not the professional team, but they're what like prep teams, essentially, their club system. And then he's going to come and play in the U.S. for a couple of seasons. Now, if this can get an end with somebody that's better than Sarr 4 years from now, I mean.
Think about it. Sarr was seen as a 4-star on Rivals coming out of high school as it was. And I believe I read somewhere, maybe Bossy said it, that he was supposed to be a 5-star level, that he actually thought that he was a 5-star level talent at some point.
He didn't have a ranking. He had a star. It's kind of like Kareem Main was at first, before they started ranking Main. He was 6'10", 215 pounds coming out of the class of 2017, committed to Wake Forest in April of 2017, and picked them over. He also visited Cal, Central Florida, and Vanderbilt.
Yeah. It broke Bryce Drew's heart when they didn't get him. And I remember when they were in the midst of recruiting him, after he took a official visit to Vanderbilt, they were hoping that he would either commit on a trip or that he would commit within the next 48 hours. And I remember having talking to one of the coaches, like, oh, probably the next Friday. And I mean, they were really heartbroken that he did not commit to them. And because I remember them saying that he is an NBA player. You know, he's a pro. He is, I mean, they had him on a level of a can't miss NBA guy. And say what you want to about Bryce Drew, but, you know, he signed Darius Garland, Semi Chatou, Saban Lee, and, oh man, the shooter absolutely slipped my mind. That's going to be drafted in the first round, all within two classes, you know, four NBA guys. Lee.
Yeah, Saban?
Huh? No, not Saban, the other guard, the one that got hurt last year. Averaged 25 a game. It's going to be taken in a lottery, probably.
Oh, yeah.
Aaron Nesmith.
Okay, yeah.
And
so, that's like a unicorn. I couldn't even remember the unicorn's name, a lottery pick out of Vanderbilt.
Oh, well, they had one the year before. I mean, he's had four NBA guys in 2 years, as bad as they've been.
I love Darius Garland's game. I always forget that he went to Vanderbilt.
Yeah, of course, he got hurt five games in. But what I'm saying is they knew – I think they really knew talent, some of the guys that were under the radar, like Nesmith and some of those guys, and they could look at them and say, this guy's really going to be good. Saban Lee was the same way. And I thought they saw that with Sarr, that like I said, they looked at him and said, look, I'm telling you, we need him. He's going to be in the NBA. So, I mean, that's what they thought about him.
Yeah. Okay, from here, we've talked about how Kentucky wanted to add two final pieces in the front court. You know, we talked in depth about who the heck that other guy might be, you know, McKerr-Maker, potential reclass options last week. Really, you know, major, major question marks, you know, next to where it is outside of the obvious, which was 2024 star center Frank Anslem. But from there, this weekend, Evansville forward DeAndre Williams popped out of nowhere, putting UK in his Final Four to go with Arkansas, Baylor, and Memphis. Now, his mentor and former coach, Kenny Roy, told me that this decision is expected by the end of this week. Travis, how do you think you know, where do you think Kentucky goes from here to close out this 2020-21 roster? And if you had to, you know, make a prediction on which one of the two they add, who would you go with?
Like I said earlier, I heard that the plan was for Sarr and Anselm, that would be the best pairing and best roster fit, managing egos and all that stuff. So I think that they're going to round out the class with Frank Anselm as a project big, and I love that addition. High upside, minimum risk adding him to this year's roster now that you have Sarr.
Yeah. David, real quick, what if you had to make a guess, do you think Anselm is that final piece?
Yeah, I think so, because I think one thing that Sarr does, it gives Calipari less stress in recruiting is post here. You know, Isaiah and Lance Ware did not have to come out and be studs right off the bat. They can kind of develop, which might mean they would be more around for another year. And then Anselm, you know, you talk about him developing. You could turn around and look at the 2021 team, and they could have three returning posts. Maybe that's what Keon Brooks do. So, you know, I think it's a lot more comfortable looking at the post situation maybe 2 years than it was looking at this post situation a couple weeks ago.
Oh, goodness. Yeah. So last week on the show, David, I know you were busy, couldn't jump on with us, but we spent the entire show basically saying, if Anselm is the answer down low for, like, you know, as an immediate impact type guy, like, holy crap, we need you to be a difference maker this year, it would have been a nightmare scenario for Kentucky. We said it was,
Jack,
you know, go for it.
I'm sorry. You probably got the same speech from Julius Smith, who was Anselm's AAU coach, that I got. And that was, he told me a couple of days ago, he said, look, we're going to wait. We may wait a couple of weeks. And he says, Kentucky has no choice but to let us wait because they're out of options. And I think that was like maybe last Thursday night, Friday night, something like that, whenever the call went down. And I know you talked to him too, but then you turn around by Saturday, Sunday, and then you've got two more trains. You got one from Evansville, and you got one from Wake Forest on the market. So that's how quickly having no options changed.
I'm telling you, man, I had a conversation. Travis and I were up till like 11 o'clock the night before we recorded, basically going, you know, because I had talked to somebody close to the Prolific program that knew his game, coached him, watched him play, also talked to a parent of, you know, screw it. I talked to Jalen Green's dad about what it was like playing. And
I had a baby.
Yeah, I was just like, screw it, whatever. Talking to both of them, I was like, I came away thinking, dude, UK's screwed. If UK goes this route and needs him to be anything more than a project big, UK is screwed. I mean, they cannot cannot force their hand and try to like convince themselves, oh, maybe we can turn him into something, you know, oh, maybe he's just a dime. No, he is a long-term project. And as we said last week, how this has unfolded with getting the instant impact guy like Olivier Sarr, the one-year guy, this is the perfect situation for Kentucky to bring in Frank Anselm. This is, if there was one way to bring in a 2-3-4 year guy like Frank, who is seen as, somebody asked me on KSR the other day, they said, how would you compare Frank Anselm to Cliff Omorui right now? And I told them, I think Frank is a year away from being where Cliff is right now. I think he is. I think he's not even remotely close yet to being that instant, you know, rebounding, you know, rim running type, you know, just high energy guy off the bench. I don't even think he's ready to be that yet. So for Kentucky to potentially add him now, given the circumstances, considering that Olivier is already signed, ready to go, I mean, man, that this is the prime opportunity for Kentucky to add Frank Anselm. Say you are, you know, we're only going to bring you in spot minutes, foul trouble, situations like that. We want you to come in. We want you to develop under Kenny Payne. We want you to learn this game. We want you to, you know, develop on both ends of the floor, build strength, add muscle, put him in the same, you know, red shirt, not, you know, whether Frank redshirts or not, you know, that same, you know, development process that Jacob Toppin's going to go on to. Just say, send both of them off into the training facility and say, work until next year. We are thrilled to bring you back next year. We are so excited to have you with the program. just not yet. That's the
Let me ask both of you this quickly. How many times, like on a Sunday, let's say, have you looked ahead and said, man, there's not going to be much to write about this week, Kentucky recruiting? I do it all the time. There's nothing. And then by Monday night, you're like begging for mercy. You're like, how am I going to get all this done?
Oh, I'm telling you. That's exactly where I am, man. This was a much-needed traffic push on the website, let me tell you that. It's been very, very, very nice to get all of this news, especially today's news. You know, with that, we didn't really talk about DeAndre Williams, but Travis, real quick, we've been talking back and forth about it. I talked to his mentor and head coach back in high school. I talked to his trainer. I talked to their associate head coach. I've talked to a bunch of people about his recruitment. Heard a lot of really, really good things. Heard he's an awesome kid. Instant impact player. Could be a really, really good player at a school. Just don't know which school that is. He's down to those four schools. We've talked a little bit, Travis. Where are you leaning right now on his recruitment?
Like I said earlier, I haven't talked to anybody at Kentucky or around Kentucky about him. But I've talked to people that are really plugged into the recruiting world and his recruitment in general, and they have said that, like, they don't think it's a good fit for Kentucky. Like, what they're – the person I talked to said that they don't think he's a good fit at Kentucky or at Memphis, that they think he's better fit at Arkansas or Baylor just for what he's wanting to do and what he can bring to the team, that his skill set isn't really different from guys that Kentucky already has. So I think that he can go somewhere like Arkansas, but the must bus can convince him that he can play the 3/4 combo at 6'10". And I think he could thrive there. I think he could thrive in that system. And only thing is, I think he would be a pro this year if he wasn't 23 years old.
Yeah, and to think he's planning on going back to another year for another year of school
to get even older. The thing is, I was reading this earlier. He's 21 as a freshman.
Yeah, it's.
And, yeah. I mean, everybody knows a couple of those guys. 20-year-old high schoolers. I knew a couple of them growing up.
Yeah, he's one of them.
I understand it.
he's definitely one of it. Yeah, I talked to his trainer. Told me that he's a 6'10" small forward, and I was like, that's interesting.
Yeah,
that's,
when he got his circle trying to push that narrative,
I was like, that's not what Kentucky's looking for at all. Like, not even remotely close. We, you know, Kentucky has all the, you know, guards and wings they could possibly ask for. You know, not necessarily looking for a 6'10" small forward. Yeah, that just didn't feel like a good fit. Talking to his head coach, Coach Roy, he told me that he couldn't have said enough positive things about Kentucky. He said they are the gold standard of college basketball, said that they're the Mecca, you know, hyped him up, said he, you know, oddly enough, he said Kenny Payne reached out for the first time midway through the week last week via text message, didn't make a phone call to you know, Coach Roy is the lead, the handler in his recruitment, kind of directs all the phone calls and makes sure, you know, DeAndre is not flooded with texts and calls all the time, but said that for the first time Kenny Payne reached out on Sunday morning about you know, Kentucky's interest and all that, then basically said, we're going to talk with Coach Cal tonight. We want you to have a Zoom meeting with him, blah, 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 blah. And Sunday is when he updated his recruitment, went from not even addressing the fact that Kentucky had, you know, because they hadn't yet. Last week, he had 30 schools reach out to him, and none of them were Kentucky. Then as of Wednesday or sometime midweek, they just send out a feeler text. Then as of Sunday was the first method of communication via, you know, voice, talking to him on the phone. And from there, he got thrown in the final four of their list, which, I mean, just kind of goes to show the level of respect that they have for the Kentucky program, that they could come in literally at the last second and become a finalist, you know, legitimate contender for his services. Now, as of now with Olivier, I just don't know why you would need another, you know, go-to pure, you know, instant impact guy at the four when you have Keon Brooks. I think that he and Keon Brooks are kind of interchangeable. And if you are going to add another guy like that, I think, you know, honestly, Frank isn't the, you know, that is the ideal situation to bring in a long-term guy, you know, considering what you're expecting out of Keon Brooks this year. So, yeah, I definitely think that that's where Kentucky's going to end things. I think they're going to, you know, turn down or have DeAndre turn them down, you know, in favor of Arkansas or Baylor, probably Arkansas if I had to guess right now, and then go after Frank Anselm to close this thing out and call it a roster. All right, and with that,
I want to ask you guys a question real quick before we wrap up. With the addition of Sarr, where do you think Kentucky would have been ranked preseason without him, and where do you think they rank now?
David, you want to go for that first?
I'm gonna say they'd end up somewhere around 15 or 20 without him. And you know, John Calipari, and the way he coaches, he's always said, if you don't have a post game, you're a pretender. And you know, that's straight out of his mouth. He's got to have one. I think now, I mean, I think they got to be top five. And yeah, you've got to remember, when everybody thought Harms was going to go to Kentucky, and that was out there, and I remember some national guys putting out the rankings, and they had included Harms in that, and everybody had them in the top five. And then they didn't get Harms, and I saw some of the same people do new rankings, and they had Kentucky like number 24 and 22, and Sarr's better than Harms. So if they get Sarr, I think they probably go up, maybe all the way number one. I don't know, but I think definitely up top five, top three.
I know I told you guys both that this team with Harms, I thought, you know, because I sent you guys this in the group message, like very early in that recruiting process, I looked up the per 40 numbers, and Harms' numbers were almost identical to Scal's in his first year at Kentucky. In fact, fans that are listening to this, go look up on Basketball Reference, look up the comparison between Harms' last year at Purdue and what Scal brought to the table in his lone season at Kentucky. And look how, I mean, it was like two, you know, within like 0.01 of, in terms of points, rebounds, blocks per game, you know, shooting percentage. I mean, it was nuts. I mean, almost identical across the board. And I told both of you guys, I was like, man, this roster, even with Harms, is almost identical to that Tyler Ulis, Jamal Murray year, where you have the two superstar guards, you know, BJ Boston, Terrence Clark being those two. You have, you know, the Keon Brooks comparing to like an Alex Poythers. You go down the list, there's a comparison, you know, Cameron Fletcher all the way down to Charles Matthews on that roster. I mean, the comparisons were almost identical, very, very bizarre. And I was like, that is the ceiling for that team with Harms. It almost identical to that round of 32 team with Tyler Ulis. This team now with Sarr, I mean, I'm telling you, I definitely think that they're pushing top five status 100% if he does get eligible. I mean, that'd be huge. Travis, did you say what you thought they'd end up being?
No, I'm right in line with you guys. I had them around like 15 to 20 range, like David said, and then I think they're top three now have a strong case for number one. I don't think they'll get the number one ranking, though, just because they're going to be – their best two players are going to be freshmen coming in, but I think that I think they'll definitely be top five at the least.
Yeah, I think no matter how it unfolds, if he is eligible, I definitely think that UK has one hell of a title, you know, title contending, Final Four level team, you know, yet another team under Calipari that is capable of winning it all. Not saying that they're a guarantee or a lock or even, you know, a lock to even get to the Final Four by any stretch, but they are capable of making a run of that caliber because they are, a really, really talented team from top to bottom across the board. With that, I think we've hit it right on the hour mark, so we can call it quits there. Travis, where can fans find your work?
You can find my work alongside David Sisk, on Cats Illustrated on the Rivals Network. Still running a 2-month free trial over there if you guys want to join and hop on. And you can follow me on Twitter at TravGraph_Rivals. And then you can listen to my podcast called the Cat Scan Podcast. Starts with a K, the Power K, actually. And tomorrow we are having a recent Kentucky commit, Lavelle Wright, on to talk about his recruitment that we're having. Wake Forest media member come on and talk about Sarr with us. So it's going to be a good episode tomorrow.
And David?
Coach David Sisk at Twitter, and I am with Travis with Cats Illustrated. And like I said, I've got Terrence Oglesby. That's my project right now. Played at Clemson, played in Europe for 8 years, and he does media work basketball-wise with Clemson. got to see a lot of Sarr, a lot of ACC ball last year, and he broke a pretty good breakdown for me. So we'll have that coming up.
Yeah, go follow their work. Go subscribe. They do awesome work over at Cats Illustrated. You can find me on Twitter at JackPilgrimKSR, via email jpilgrim@kentuckysportsradio.com. And with that, we will be back next week for another jam-packed Sources Say podcast. We will see you then.